what is the relationship between obesity and the kidneys, followed by the management of obesity as far as patients with renal disease. And then we will also talk about something called as obesity paradox. So let me begin by saying that this topic is so important for all of us that even the International Society of Nephrology decided to take up this topic in 2017, and the theme of the World Kidney Day, which was celebrated in 2017 on the 9th of March, was kidney disease and obesity. It just underlines the fact that obesity is a big problem in not only in the general population, but as far as the kidneys are concerned, again, obesity has a lot of issues of management as well as the associations between obesity and kidney disease. And this, of course, underlines the importance of obesity and the kidney disease. So it's a major public health problem across the world. And usually it results from excessive caloric intake, decreased energy expenditure, or a combination of both. Now, usually overweight and obesity are defined as abnormal or excessive fat accumulation, which is risky to the general well-being and the health of the person. And previously, it has always been diagnosed by the BMI, which we are well aware of. Now, all of us know that the world currently is facing an obesity pandemic. And here you can see the figures in some of the representative countries. In the United States, in the population, the prevalence in females is about 24.7%, while in males it's about 19.7%. If you look at the Indian figures, they are similar, 25.6% in females and 19.3% in males. And the age range can be as low as 16 years and as high as 64 years in India. So therefore, it underlines the fact that age is no bar as far as obesity is concerned. Sex is also no bar. Females are more prone to obesity as compared to males. And these are figures almost all over the place and all over the world. So around 800 million people across the world are living with obesity. More than 135 million individuals are affected by obesity in India. And of course, when we say obesity, it is majorly abdominal obesity, which is a risk factor for cardiovascular diseases. Even in India, we have the second highest number of obese children after China. And 7 out of 10 adults and 4 out of 11 children are at risk of obesity. And as I already mentioned, females are more prone for obesity as compared to males. Now, what are the factors which affect the development of obesity? You can see here, genetic factors could be predominant, but then there are a lot of external factors like behavior, environmental factors, the culture issues, socioeconomic status, energy imbalance, which I mentioned right in the beginning. And of course, there are some metabolism related issues. All these can contribute to obesity. Now, as far as the BMI as a parameter of diagnosis is concerned, the NIH has given this definition in 1998. Less than 18.5 BMI is underweight. 18.5 to 24.9 is normal. And then you have overweight, 25 to 29.9, and then class 1, class 2, and class 3 obese people, 30 to 35, 35 to 39.9, and more than 40. And as far as the Asian criteria is concerned, they are slightly different. You can see that the underweight criteria are the same as far as the WHO and the Asian criteria, but the overweight criteria are slightly different. In the Asian phenotype, 23 to 24.9 is considered as overweight, while in the WHO criteria, 25 to 29.9 is considered as overweight. All the other figures are almost the same. There is an additional category called pre-obesity or pre-obese individuals in the Asian subgroup, 25 to 29.9, which is defined as overweight by WHO criteria. And that is considered as pre-obese in the Asian criteria. Rest of the figures are almost matching as far as definition of type 1, type 2 and type 3 obesity is concerned. Now, what are the other measures of body fat which are available? You can also measure body fat by skin fold thicknesses, bioelectrical impedance, underwater weighing, and dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. Now, waist to hip ratio is also considered as a standard for diagnosis of obesity. In males, 0.9, females, 0.85. Now, that is also nowadays considered in many of the studies for diagnosis of obesity. There's another parameter besides BMI called as Body Adiposity Index or BAI. So BAI is an alternative index based on hip circumference and height. And this is termed as the Body Adiposity Index. Now the formula is Body Adiposity Index is hip circumference in centimeters divided by height in meters into 1.5 minus 18. That is the formula for Body Adiposity Index. And as if you employ this as a criterion, then the BAI classification for women and men is different. If you are between 20 to 39 years old, and if the BAI is less than 21, you are considered as underweight. 21 to 33 is normal, and greater than 33 is overweight. Similarly, in men, if you are between 40 to 59 years old, if the BAI is less than 11%, then this is underweight. And 11 to 23% is considered as healthy. Greater than 23 is overweight, and greater than 29 is obese. So you have different criteria based on body adiposity index, and one can diagnose obesity on the basis of not only BMI, but the body adiposity index. Now, what are the health consequences of high BMI or obesity in adults? All of us are very well aware of various problems related to obesity, like high blood pressure, fatty liver disease, increased risk of stroke, diabetes, kidney diseases, sleep apnea, osteoarthritis, etc., etc. Besides that, of course, you have mental disorders, a poor quality of life, some association with various cancers and heart disease. All these are factors which are important, and they have very important association with obesity. And we are aware that there are many treatment related issues in all these individuals. Now, what causes obesity? Basically, it is energy imbalance over a long period of time, when energy in is more than energy out, excess calories and lack of physical activity. I was talking about what causes obesity. So basically, energy in is more than energy out, and excess calories and lack of physical activity. Now, we must remember that energy balance is like a scale. When calories consumed are greater than calories used, then of course you must gain weight. And it depends on, of course, unhealthy food choices also. What are the environmental factors that promote overeating? Availability of fast foods and snacks, easy accessibility to food, low cost, a good taste, big portion sizes, high fat content, and energy dense, high carbohydrate soft drinks. Now, there are many factors which reduce physical activity. Basically, it is related to technological advances in most of the occupations, and even in daily living and household activities, there are technological advances, which is causing a sedentary lifestyle, and therefore, naturally, obesity is the result. Now, there is a lot of debate going on about the obesity, and there's monumental shifts in the obesity dialogue. For example, previously it was thought that overweight and obesity is looks, personal appearance, and fitting into societal norms. But now we know that overweight and obesity is not about looks, it's about health. Previously, the notion was fighting obesity is all about individual will. It begins and ends with a personal responsibility. But now the thought is fighting obesity is about good personal choices and a society where good choices are possible. That means you must have the opportunity for that. The third thought would be all you have to do is to beat obesity is to lose weight. But when it comes to beating obesity, losing weight may be easy, but maintenance of that weight loss is hard. So all these points should be remembered as far as new thoughts in obesity. Now let's come to obesity and kidney. Now it is well known that a high BMI is one of the great risk factors for a new onset CKD. And obesity has been identified as a major cause of kidney disease, including CKD. Of course, we know that there is close association of CKD with diabetes, hypertension, and obesity. And obesity influences development of CKD in diabetic nephropathy, hypertensive nephrosclerosis, as well as some correlation with FSGS. What is the prevalence of CKD in obesity? In stage 1, the prevalence is about 37.7% when the GFR is near normal. And if you look at stage 4 and stage 5, it's about the same, 37.8% approximately. In stage 2 and 3, it is slightly higher. So therefore, it is across the stages of CKD, you can see that it is prevalent, obesity is prevalent. How does obesity cause CKD? The exact mechanism is still to be deciphered. It's a complex of various metabolic issues. And I already mentioned about diabetes, hypertension, but adiposity per se will cause reduction in adiponectin levels and increase in the leptin levels. This ultimately causes insulin resistance, RAS activation, inflammation, and increase in the oxidative stress. And this causes abnormal lipid metabolism. Now, there are some specific pathologic changes in the kidneys which occur due to ectopic lipid accumulation, increased deposition of renal sinus fat, development of intraglomerular hypertension, and hypertension-related glomerular injury. This leads to glomerulomegaly and focal and segmental glomerulosclerosis, as you can see here, as this was a publication in the American Journal of Nephrology in 2017. Now, what are the mechanisms of obesity affecting the kidneys? Basically, these people have a compensatory hyperfiltration to meet the heightened metabolic demands of increased body weight, and there is an increase in the intraglomerular pressure. So there are two mechanisms. One is the hemodynamic problem related to increase in the vascular tone, renal salt and water retention due to various factors. And of course, stimulation of the RAS pathway results in renal sodium and water retention. In addition to the hemodynamic injury, you have hyperfiltration injury related to increase in the renal blood flow and elevated GFR initially. And of course, this also gives rise to FSGS later on. So obesity can have indirect effects on the kidney by way of hypertension, atherosclerosis, which is progressive, and diabetes. And you can have direct effects due to glomerular hypertension, pro-inflammatory cytokines, increase in the RAS stimulation, and the progression of CKD to incident ESRD. At the same time, there are some precipitating phenomena, which you can see on your left-hand side, which ultimately give rise to some pathogenic stimuli like hyperinsulinemia, increase in sympathetic drive, and compression of the perirenal and renal veins and renal tubules, which is also supposed to be another putative mechanism. And the response for this pathogenic stimuli is kidney sodium retention, kidney cell injury, glomerular hyperfiltration, glomerulopathy, tubular atrophy, etc., etc. Now, the obesity is, of course, due to various factors which I already mentioned. And there could be some comorbid factors. And therefore, please remember that this ultimately causes clinical manifestations of hypertension, atherosclerosis, obesity, and ultimately give rise to chronic kidney disease. This is a seminal publication in the EDTA Clinical Kidney Journal in 2017, which was linked to the World Kidney Day. Obesity and kidney disease, the hidden consequences of the epidemic. Again, it underlined the fact that there's a close relation between obesity and kidney disease, and this is to the tune of epidemic proportions, and one needs to be well aware of this. There's something called as obesity-related glomerulopathy. This is a publication in KI in 2001. First large renal biopsy-based clinicopathologic study on obesity-related glomerulopathy. And here they found that though the histopathology was similar to FSGS, some factors or some criteria were different as compared to idiopathic FSGS. So this FSGS is not the same as the idiopathic FSGS. And the incidence of obesity-related glomerulopathy has worsened in the last 10 years. And of course, it has shown a tenfold rise. Now, we know that numerous studies have shown that there's an association between obesity and progression of CKD. If you already have a CKD, then it is going to progress because the GFR falls, there is progression of proteinuria, and there's a rapid loss of GFR over a period of time. Again, this is a publication in the American Journal of Nephrology. There are some other effects of obesity on the kidney, like lower urinary pH, increase in the urinary oxalate, and therefore increased sodium and phosphate excretion. Therefore, increased risk of kidney stone formation is also there because of the acidic milieu and nephrolithiasis. Similarly, there's a very close correlation between hyperuricemia, metabolic syndrome, and the cardiac risk factors. I need not go into the details of this, but ultimately this causes endothelial dysfunction and vascular issues both in the heart and the kidney. A study published in the UK found that higher BMI was associated with a 25% higher risk of kidney cancers, and 10% of all kidney cancers was attributable to excess weight. So again, malignancy can also be related to obesity. So to summarize the relationship between obesity and the kidney, you have initially hemodynamic and physiologic changes because of obesity. Then you have anatomic changes, which I mentioned, going on to pathophysiologic problems, then going on to CKD, and then, of course, the other associations which I already mentioned. Let us come to management. Remember, prevention is the key. It has to be a teamwork, and the goal has to be individualized for every person. And the components of management would be starting with education and motivation, diet modification, increase in physical activity. Parents and your peers can be role models, and of course, medications and surgical treatment. The right approach is, if you have a BMI between 25 and 30, then see to it that you don't gain any additional weight, and you must try to lose weight by some means. Periodic nutritional screening is important by way of weight, BMI, and waist to hip ratio. And of course, you can do the additional body composition assessment by anthropometrics and the conicity index. And preventive measures of obesity by nutrition counseling and management of comorbidities, etc., is important. And of course, then ultimately you have to do interventions. So there are some weight loss strategies by way of dietary interventions. Reduce the caloric intake to less than 900 calories per day, and some exercise interventions and alterations in food content. If there is no improvement, then of course intensified therapy could be with pharmacological interventions. And if you improve, then of course you need to maintain that by doing the right thing. So nutritional counseling, optimization of diet, avoidance of high calories, management of comorbidities, and encouragement of physical activity is very, very important after the initial diagnosis of obesity. And if you have proper weight loss strategies, then you are going to get good results. And if you do that, and if you stabilize, then you must maintain the therapy goals. And if you don't get the right results, then of course you will have pharmacological interventions and bariatric surgery. A quick chart about what kind of activity will give rise to how much calories loss and per hour. So for example, running at 10 miles per hour, 850 calories for a 100-pound individual, and 1,664 calorie loss for a 200-pound individual per hour. So similarly, we can have some calculations and tell the patient, you need, if you want to lose so many calories, then you need to do this kind of activity. What about the food pyramid? You can see here that the bread and cereal group is the biggest group. Then you have the vegetable group, fruit group, meat and poultry, milk, yogurt, and the fats. Of course, we know that eat plenty of fruits, vegetables, grains, and legumes. Now, this is not true for CKD patients. This is true for general population when you're trying to lose weight. All of us know that the CKD population is different, and there are lots of caveats as far as diet is concerned for CKD. So this particular recommendation which I am presenting here is for general people with obesity. Now, balanced eating is important. You can eat small meals and avoid processed food, fresh fruits and vegetables, substituting water for all soft drinks and fruit juices, limiting alcohol consumption, and low-fat dairy products should not be used. What is the bottom line about diet? Follow the food pyramid, low-calorie diet, avoid junk food, practice moderation, parents are the role models, etc., etc. What is the role of medications? Now, what is the role of pharmacotherapy in obesity? If you don't get the results only by diet alone and exercise alone, then sometimes you have to use pharmacotherapy. These are the drugs which can be used. Remember that there are a lot of do's and don'ts as far as selection of drugs is concerned. Some of them have been FDA approved, but drugs like sibutramine, the drug has been withdrawn some time ago. But I want to point your attention to liraglutide, which is a GLP-1 receptor agonist, and that is going to come in a big way as far as weight loss is concerned, and right now it is off-label use. You have some medical devices for weight management, which I am not going to discuss, intragastric balloons, electrical stimulation, and gastric emptying systems, as well as bariatric surgery. Again, we are going to have a talk on that, so therefore I am not going to discuss about that. Just one small pointer about renoprotective effects of bariatric surgery in people with CKD. So if you have poor bariatric surgery, then you have specific bariatric effects in patients with CKD. Again, there are some metabolic effects related to incretin and intestinal gluconeogenesis. And there are some antihypertensive effects related to reduction in leptin levels and insulin. So bariatric surgery is very useful in some selected patients with CKD, and plenty of studies to show that depending on what is the type of intervention and what is the impact on GFR and on proteinuria, you can see here that diet, there are 5 studies, exercise and some combination treatment also. Now, prevention of CKD progression in obese people with CKD, these are the last few slides. Brain study showed that a nephron protective effect of ACE inhibition by proteinuria CKD patients was maximal in obese patients, and it was less in non-obese patients. So bariatric surgical intervention has been suggested in people with CKD, besides, of course, lifestyle intervention. And this is just a flow chart to show you what is the effect of renal function, risk modification, preventive measurement, therapeutic aspects as far as stages of CKD is concerned, and even in patients with transplantation. Remember that in kidney transplant patients, obesity could be a contraindication to do the transplant, and it can lead to impaired graft function. The last part of my presentation, once CKD is acquired, obesity is paradoxically associated with improved survival, particularly among those receiving hemodialysis. This is described as obesity paradox, in which short-term benefits of obesity may outweigh its long-term risk. So here you can see that dual role of obesity is a risk factor for the development of progression of chronic kidney disease. So initially, obesity is causing CKD. It is causing progression of CKD, causing protein energy malnutrition. But once the patient starts hemodialysis, and in the later stages of CKD, obesity is supposed to be beneficial. This is called as the obesity paradox. Reverse association of BMI and survival in CKD patients as compared to the general population. So here you can see that you are underweight initially, and patients with advanced CKD with morbid obesity, you can see that there is some benefit of survival. The survival graph is going up. And progression to ESRD initially takes place, but all-cause mortality is less in people with obesity. So you need to have a nuanced approach as far as obesity in patients with advanced kidney disease is concerned. Although it is a major risk factor, and is in some patients with CKD, it could be a protective factor in patients undergoing hemodialysis, and the same thing is seen in non-CKD population also. And there are some putative benefits because of better nutritional status, a higher muscle mass would be a, due to stable hemodynamic status, increased adiponectin levels, and enhanced binding of circulating endotoxins. These are the mechanisms by which obesity could be protective in some patients with CKD. So to conclude, the incidence of obesity has been increasing worldwide. Diseases of kidneys, including CKD, nephrolithiasis, and kidney cancers, are associated with obesity. And this, of course, leads to progression of CKD. And we need to have population-wise interventions to control obesity, even in patients with CKD. And we must be aware about the importance of association between obesity and CKD and kidney other kidney diseases also. And we need to really be cautious about treatment of obese people with CKD. In the future, I feel that the primary care physicians are the people who are going to make people aware about association between obesity and CKD improvement and the risk of GFR, proteinuria, comorbidity, etc., etc. I thank you for attention, and remember this message on the World Kidney Day. Move for kidneys. This is what the International Society of Nephrology promoted in 2017. Thank you for your attention.